HCL Tech has come out with a strong set of earnings for the period from January to March, where we've seen their bottom line grow 12.3%, which is ahead of street estimates. So talk to me about the earnings. We are joined by Mr. C. Vijay Kumar and Mr. Charana. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us on NDTV Profit. Mr. Vijay Kumar, so the earnings have come in largely in line with expectations, especially the revenues, slightly lower on a reported basis, 2.3%. We were looking around 4%. On constant currency basis, up 4%. So during this quarter, did things go out as you planned? Because for the entire year, if you look at FY17 growth, it is pretty good. Your revenues are up 14%. So what worked for you during this quarter?
Yep. So thank you, Anisha. It's been a fantastic quarter. We pretty much executed as we kind of committed in the beginning of the quarter. And as an overall year, it's really been a brilliant year. We really did very well in terms of revenue growth, in terms of expansion in our margins. We came in at the higher end of our guided margins. If you really look at what is working for us, right? I mean, when I took over as a CEO about 3 quarters back, one of the big mandate was to really how to transform or evolve ourselves into the next generation technology services company. That was the big thing, right? While always you can focus and grow in some traditional services, but what is more important from a long-term perspective is how are you being relevant to your clients for the next generation services and products and platforms. I think that's where we've significantly moved the needle in the last 3 quarters. If you look at our mode 2 and mode 3 revenues, which is really our digital analytics, IoT works, cybersecurity, and cloud native services, and our production platform, from a year-on-year perspective, we've grown 31%. I think that's really what we're going to track on an ongoing basis to see how are we evolving. So it's two main themes of performance, extremely good performance, industry-leading performance in terms of revenue and margin, mostly at the higher end of the range, and I think accelerating evolution into the next generation technology services firm. I think we are really moving the needle in this dimension.
What is the organic growth? Because you also had a number of acquisitions. There was Butler, then you had Geometric. So what is the organic growth posted by?
I'm sure this, I knew this was coming, but I mean, if you really look at whenever we announced inorganic acquisition, we've just provided the numbers from an annual perspective, and any IP partnerships, we've also announced the investments and the potential revenues, right? So it's pretty much in line with what we had broadly communicated to the street. So I do believe our organic growth is also the best in the industry. It's close to double digits. So it's fairly good performance. And I think when we look at inorganic, I think what you have to really see is it's really not diluted our EBIT performance or the margin performance, right? In spite of inorganic, we continue to maintain and improve our margin performance. And this quarter, in spite of strengthening rupee, we came in at 20%, and the overall year, we came in at the higher end of the guidance.
That's my question to you, Mr. Chanana. How have you managed this performance on your EBIT margins? They are marginally lower from the previous quarter, but that was actually anticipated. We expected a little bit of margin contraction because the some of the acquisitions have been margin dilutive. Now what happens from here on? Are you going to stay within the range? I think you're guiding between 19.5 and 20.5. Is that the guidance?
Yes, correct. That's correct. So Anisha, what we have done is if you look at the next year guidance, for FY17, before I go to the next year guidance, for whole of financial year 17, the average exchange rate has been close to 67. So what we have given and our guidance was 19.5 to 20.5. However, for FY18, we have given the same guidance at a lower dollar rupee rate, which is 65 rupees and 50 paisa. So in effect, I mean, we have upped our guidance, I would say, on margin front.
Right. What was the impact of the currency during the fourth quarter?
I think it was about 50 odd basis points, but it was offset by the efficiency in the business. Yeah.
Vijay Kumar, you spoke about the organic growth. You also have this mode 1, 2, 3 strategy. Now, is the focus now going to be to invest in the products and platforms business? And how far is your partnership with IBM helping you here? You've invested a huge amount now in this partnership, right? It's about 500 million, right? What are you expecting out of it? What progress have you made in the fourth quarter?
Yeah, sure. Definitely, we believe a very significant element of our evolution into the next generation company, which is really the Mode 2 and Mode 3 services, is about building organic and inorganic capabilities. Right. And in the Mode 2 services, we have really created very strong practices. We've really pulled out some senior leaders and created a strong practice in a manner that it brings in all the good capabilities that we have in our engineering services, in our industry leading infrastructure business and our application business, and try and bring it in a manner that we can contextualize it to the client. Like IoT Works is a very strong proposition, which we are well ahead of the market, where we're bringing all these services in a manner that you can deliver a business outcome for our clients. So that's really the strategy in terms of our Mode 2 services, really experience-centric and outcome-oriented, and bring together all the services in a cohesive manner to deliver an outcome. In terms of Mode 3, we do believe the future is really going to be driven by production platform, and that's the reason we are organically investing as well. We have a significant amount of products and IPs that we've developed over the last 2 decades. Some of them are really very, very powerful differentiators for us in the ITO business, and we continue to invest in them, build more and more organic products and platform services. And in terms of the strategic partnership with IBM, yes, we have invested. We do believe there is a big opportunity in modernizing some of the software products to be making them relevant for cloud and IoT. And this quarter, we continue to invest, and we have we've acquired a database solution which we can go into an IoT solution, and that there's a huge scalability possible. Right? So this strategic partnership is performing in line with our expectations largely, and we will continue to walk that path.
What are clients talking to you about spending? Because while the newer businesses, there is spending. What's happening in the legacy business? And a lot of companies are now talking about hiring more in the US. Is that something you're going to be doing? And then what happens to cost?
I think the two questions, let me address one by one. In terms of client spending, if you look at any forecast, like Gartner had, it was 4.3% growth in the previous quarter. They've reduced it to 2.3%. So that's really at a macro level. But if you look at our customer base, I do believe the IT spending is flat or marginally growing. It's pretty much the same commentary that I gave in the last quarter. Maybe marginally, it's just growing. But however, what you have to see is there's a lot of money being spent in innovation, and they try and extract as much cost out from the traditional services and reinvest in innovation. On innovation, one very important data point is for every $1 spent on innovation, you need $7 to ensure that innovation is executed. Right? And that's the biggest opportunity for a service provider like us, right? To execute a digital program, to conceptualize an IoT program, to migrate a lot of your workloads to a very flexible native cloud kind of environments. That's where the biggest opportunity is. So this whole demand environment and the spending, it all depends on what lens you look at. Right. If you look at it from a traditional services, it looks a little bit gloomy. But if you look at it from new generation services, it's absolutely exciting, and that's what our focus is and our investments and growth strategies all around that.
Right. I wanted to ask Mr. Channana also that if hiring locally in the US, is it poised to increase? What happens to your margins then? You're holding out to a margin 19.5 to 20.5.
The hiring is factored in, but I think before I come to the hiring, I think it's important that we made an early investment in setting up about 12 delivery centers in the US, and we have 12,000 people in the US, and they are most of them are not visa dependent, so I think they are locals. So we have already invested in that. Of course, we'll continue to invest in that delivery center in US as well as in other geographies. So it's a part of the journey, and it's very well factored into our guidance.
Just to add to what Anil said, I think we were very early in taking these calls to really make our business model very resilient to any geographic and immigration challenges. Actually, I'm really surprised that some of the players are talking about adding people in the US now. Mm-hmm. This is something which we recognized 7 to 8 years back. We have 12 delivery centers in the US. Mm-hmm. We have 12,000 people onshore, greater than 55% of them are locals. Mm-hmm. So we were very, very ahead of the industry to really identify this risk and gradually mitigate it, right? And that's one reason we're not really concerned on the margins or anything for this particular element.
What were the large deal wins in this quarter? And for the next FY18, what kind of deals are you looking at? What's the pipeline like?
We signed about 8 transformational deals last quarter. Overall in fiscal 17, it's been a great year. We had 42 transformational wins. They're pretty balanced across mode 1 and 2 and 3, and it's also balanced across service lines. We had a very large information services management company in the US where we did an end-to-end infrastructure and application services deal, which leverages our dry ice platform, which leverages our cloud migration strategy, all of that, right? We also won a very large deal with a healthcare services provider in the US, which has gone into steady state this quarter. We're also very strongly positioned on the mode 2 services. We won marquee logos in IoT works, logos which were which we wouldn't have been able to acquire through our mode 1 services because there is a lot of entrenched players in those customers. But because our proposition is very strong in mode 2, especially IoT works and digital, and that we won a few, I mean at least 3 marquee logos across the world on mode 2 services. And a number of programs in our existing customers, some of them are big programs, some of them are small, are all in the areas of mode 2. Actually, if you see 62% of our customer base, of the top 150 customers, are taking our services in mode 2, either as large programs or at least piloting with us, really looking at how we can deliver the next generation services.
Right. Mr. Tanana, what is the sentiment like in the market now? We are hearing of large-scale firings happening. Are your employees a little demotivated? What's the attrition like? Is there a sense of fear on what's going to happen to hiring locally and then firing also taking place in this industry now?
I think we talked about the hiring locally so far as US is concerned, and in other geographies also we continue to hire. But if you look at our sort of a business, we are growing. We are growing in double digit. So we need people and to
We're
execute. So I think, and if you look at our attrition rate, it has come down by 100 bps this quarter. So I think we are doing well on the people front.
One last question, Mr. Vijay Kumar, on the FY18 guidance. You're guiding for a growth between 10.5% to 12.5%. So if we look at your organic growth, it will still perhaps be slightly ahead of the other larger peers that you have and in line with what the NASSCOM had predicted?
So I'm not really benchmarking with NASSCOM, and I also really don't want to focus on organic and inorganic because at the end of the day, we are significantly improving our EBIT profile, right? And in terms of our core services, organic growth, I do believe we'll have an industry-leading performance. But more than looking at the total growth, I think the best way to look at the industry is how much you are moving the needle on the new generation services. I think that will be the good long-term indicator of how companies are evolving in this new world.
What is the percentage of mix coming from the new gen business now, from the revenue mix?
So as I mentioned, between FY16 and FY17, we grew 30.9%. In terms of mix of services, it used to be about 15.8% in FY16, and this year, FY17, it's close to 19%. So we've significantly moved needle on the new generation services.
Thank you so much, gentlemen, for speaking with us
at
NDTV. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're talking to the management of HCL Tech that has come out with its fourth quarter earnings ahead of street estimates. We're now joined by Mr. Karan Puri, who heads the consumer and commercial services business, and Mr. Rahul Singh, who heads the financial services business. Welcome, gentlemen, to NDTV Profit. Mr. Singh, for the financial services business, we've seen a 3% sequential growth coming through. Was most of this in the US? Can you tell us what happened in the fourth quarter? How did the growth transpire?
Right, so we've been having good sequential growth the last couple of quarters. It's the mix between North America and Europe, so far as the growth is concerned. And, you know, we find similar trends between the two markets, you know, both the global markets, Europe and US. There is a lot of focus on the millennial in terms of retail business. There's a lot of focus on capital markets in terms of costs. So these are the areas in which we are seeing some traction in the markets.
Right. In the European region, as a whole, the business declined. Did you see any pressure points in the financial services business? Where did we see good growth? Was it across the banks, financial systems? What kind of deals were signed, and where did you see traction?
So for the financial services business, as I mentioned, it was equal growth in both the geographies. And we found new deals coming both in mode one as well as in mode two. Mm-hmm. For us, mode two is very critical because financial services are a large consumer of mode two products, digital analytics, security, etc., very large for financial services. But at the same time, if you look at the customer profile that we are servicing, which includes large capital market firms, there is a lot of renewal which also happens there in terms of the mode one businesses, which is driven by automation, autonomics, and dry ice.
So did you get any contracts that were renewed during this time?
Yes, so we had a combination of contracts. There were some renewals which happened in our client base, as well as there were some new contracts which were signed. Mm-hmm. And we found the larger new contracts coming, in digital services, digital analytics services. Plus we had a couple of framework deals, which are essentially right to do business in the accounts, where the mining has started to happen this mm-hmm. quarter.
And how much more do you think, because of the mining, will you get repeat business going ahead?
The way this business works is that if you look at large financial services firms, they do tend to have businesses coming, over the quarters. So once you get a position in the account, mm-hmm. then you work with the teams, in the client teams as well as in our teams, mm-hmm. and you look at new opportunities as the client spend increases. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at the client spend is increasing, more in the digital space, so far as financial institutions are concerned. The financial companies are looking at the millennial as a large client base, as I mentioned earlier. So the millennials are driving client spends, both in insurance and retail banks. And they tend to be more connected, they tend to be more real time, there's a lot of security spend which happens there. So that's the kind of spend that we are seeing growth in. At the same time, in the capital market firms, we find that our clients are concerned about, overall costs, are concerned still about the regulatory spends which are there. So that's the market where we're looking at, working with our customers in improving their cost base through automation, through autonomics and dry ice propositions, and at the same time getting involved in the regulatory spend for them.
Mr. Puri, for the other businesses, what were the big deal wins coming in the fourth quarter, and what was the kind of growth see?
I think the quarter has been quite good and robust. Unlike the last quarter, if you recall, we talked about some dampening in a couple of verticals which usually would desist from investing or signing off on projects in the high season. This quarter, the reverse has actually happened. And interestingly, it's also come in about from sectors which we normally would not see coming in very strong in the first quarter of the calendar year. And I think that's also coming from the fact that there's business shrinkage in some of these verticals which have resulted in an absolute investment phase kicking off very early in the financial year itself. So I think we're seeing that impact come through very.
Which kind of segments are these?
Utilities, for example, which we had never seen come as early as the last quarter. Commissioning of projects that are going to pan several quarters. Mm. We had not kind of seen that. The interesting thing that's happened in the last maybe three odd quarters, and I think CVK was alluding to this earlier as well, that people have got into pilot stages of a lot of change transformation projects. Now we're seeing the roll-on effect of those projects across a diverse set of industries, which is something that automatically kicks in revenue, obviously kicks in a cadence of projects that come beyond what it is. And that's also accelerating into that 31% growth that we've seen in mode 2, mode 3. Actually now the roll-on effect of the initial pilots in myriad set of industries.
And the 8 transformational deals that were signed, what would this mean in terms of business in the quarters ahead? Are these largely mode 2, mode 3 deals? What happens
most
now?
Most of them would be mode 2 deals. Mm. And mode 2 is today not so much only business facing. It actually is a lot more where the industry is being reinvented or the process is being reset. To the fact that today when you look at, as an example, medical devices, the nature of data that we mine from that, how it's flowed back into the product design itself, elements which you had not kind of factored in the earlier way of implementing the same solutions. I think that itself has become a change for the transformation deals. So 5 out of the 8 actually are fundamentally going to alter business processes.
We've seen that engineering and R&D services have seen a very strong growth. Is this going to continue like double-digit growth? What was the traction in the IMS division as well? because those are large components of the revenue mix.
So engineering, we had obviously made a couple of smaller acquisitions. Also, engineering also defining a lot of more to change. So when you look at, let's say, IoT, connected worlds, connected devices, connected cities, smart cities as we call them, it is just the fact that we as a core, as a company, we've been effectively a platform engineering company. Yeah. That is really where it's a lot of this tailwind is coming through in engineering. The second question on whether it will continue, I definitely believe it's going to continue. As long as there's more to in scale.
Growth rate of double digits, you think it's going to continue for engineering services?
There's nothing that will stop us from doing it because that's the core business we come in and present ourselves with, which is also a differentiator for us. It doesn't come naturally for competition to come in and step in the same way as we would just because of a legacy of engineering.
Are there any concerns in Europe because of Brexit and, you know, concerns about elections and growth rate there? The growth there has been good, but I mean, now the negotiations with Brexit will start. So any worries in Europe?
See, at 15%, you couldn't complain year on year. I think that's something we're going to be proud of, frankly. We've seen some Mode 1 contract refactoring. It's not uncommon today when you look at Mode 1 deals, they have to get refactored and, you know, represent themselves. It did show up in the quarter, last quarter. But Brexit to me is still something in the future. I think the, any amount of speculation right now is speculation. I think we'll leave it at that for now and see how it
goes. What's the deal pipeline for the financial services? Going ahead, where do you see good traction? In the US, in the rest of the world? Yeah. And what in terms of deals is lined up?
Right, so the way our client-facing strategy in financial services works is that, you know, we have a select set of about 40 accounts. And we obviously increase that every year, 40 becomes 42, 44, but that's the kind of number we add new accounts on, about maybe about, you know, two or three a year. Our focus in accounts is to have a cross-sell strategy, you know, which means that, look, you get into the account and then you mine your way through and extract, you know, more value, both for the customer as well as for us. So when we look at the deal pipeline, we're essentially talking of increased mining in our existing accounts, right? That's the way we look at it. We tend to deal with the larger financial services firms. Larger financial services firms' total IT spend is either flat or slightly increasing. It's not like very large increase, but definitely 2 to 3% increase. And our effort is to try and be in that segment of our clients' spend, you know, where there's a higher growth happening, right? And we try to align there and then work on deals as it comes. So at this point of time, you know, when I look at deal pipeline, I look more at my clients and I look at what their IT spends are. And then from there, we look at opportunities which are there to grow.
Right. Mr. Puri, there are large IT companies that talk about the challenges in the current environment. There is uncertainty in the US because of the new Trump administration policies, be it on visas, be it on overhauling the healthcare system, be it on a number of issues and things they want to do in the US. Now, how are you navigating this space? Why is it that you're sounding so much more confident while your peers are saying that it's challenging, we don't see very strong growth? Is it because you're focusing on the high growth business? What happens to the legacy business? That also, you know, is a part of your business overall.
Right.
So how are you going to, you know, outperform what everybody else is doing? When they're talking of challenges, you're upbeat about growth.
I think in the way we define the market, so let's look at the political climate. I think that's the more interesting part for almost everybody. What the Trump administration is now saying or presenting itself as is not too different from what happened to the Japanese car makers a couple of decades ago. See what they did with that. They transformed industry, they built locally, they created enough jobs locally, and they've now become pretty much the owner of that industry. In some way, what we're trying to do is something which, and for the last maybe now 8 years, we've been doing this now. We built one location after the other in the Americas. We today have a dozen delivery centers. We are a majority non-visa workforce in North America. No one else comes close amongst the Indian competitors. We made those investments. We don't have to factor in increment in salaries today by design because we don't suffer the same syndrome. So that's, I think, the fundamental component. So to me, it's an opportunity of hiring more local talent, doing more, and more of what we have done successfully over the last several years. So that's insofar as the political challenge is concerned. The first part of the question you asked was, why are we more bullish? I think the point Rahul also alluded, it's about wallet share. We are currently in about 31 Fortune 100 companies in the Americas. We're talking of single digit wallet shares with all the growth that we've seen as HCL. I would love to see some more wallet share there. There is no dearth of opportunity in that sense. The change that they're going through and the dollar that they're investing is actually happening in the mode two, or what we call the transformation side, is also where we are following with the investment. So to be chasing that dollar is the center stage of our growth strategy. Mm-hmm. And it'll scale the way we're currently predicting it to be. I'm more than bullish about it.
Right, but when it comes to pricing, for traditional business, you know, there's no growth, it's always flat, it's very competitive. And when the newer businesses, the growth is great, but the size of the deals are small. So what's happening with pricing overall?
It's the deal that is not there. The spend is there. Hmm. So there is no announcement. And the reason is simple. The mode one, or the large infrastructure-led, large ASM projects, were largely done by third-party consulting companies who would advise them how to create a large transaction, because that's how they were rewarded. Mode two is about a business stakeholder wanting a change. And that change essentially starts with a pilot, showcasing some success, making that success relevant to the business. And then there's a cadence of projects after that, which is really the roll-on effect I talked about earlier as well.
So how many pilots were you doing? And how many are actually translating into business now?
So at any point in time, a customer will give you five or six different things to try on. Yeah. Two or three of them definitely yield some positive business-funded projects. Yeah. And then they don't stop. Then it's a question of taking a new geography, a new product line, a new way of delivering it, and just that's the cadence that we'll offer. So there's no transaction which says big deal, X value, announced, celebrated. Yeah. Well defined, and then there's cadence after that.
Thank you, gentlemen, for speaking with us at NDTV.
Thank you.
Thank you.